No,
Record.
it's not there.
I'm recording, yeah. Okay, I'm gonna admit all.
Hello. Hi, welcome. Welcome. I'm taking off waiting room.
Yeah.
You have disabled waiting room. Hi, welcome Amit, Ankita. Hi, Bhavna. Welcome, Disha.
Hi.
Indu. Hi, Ishita. Good to see you back.
Hey,
Janoon. Hey, Ishita. Ishita from Aruba, Bombay. Nitin, Pushpa. Hi, Sakshi. Welcome. Welcome, Shesi, Tanika, Akhil, Arpit, Goel. Hi, Sheena. Welcome
to. I don't know if I was muted my thing. Hi, Pushpa.
Welcome to the part two of the volunteer management webinar. Were you there for the first one? Was anyone here there for the volunteer management first edition?
I was.
Who said that? Sorry. Hi, Samshi.
Bharat said that.
Well, thank God for that, Bharat. Hi, Bhaskar Simha, you were not there. All right, thank you for that. Don't worry, we're going to do a recap. Yeah, I'll just hand it off over to you, Divya. Go for it. I'm going to mute my mic.
Just a second.
Chaitra was there. Sakshi was there. Good.
Should we wait for another 3 minutes? Not five yet.
Sure.
Let's wait.
So while we're waiting, Chiku, do you want to pull up the questions that we got permission to ask loudly? If you recognize any of the names, maybe Bharat can start now to get the ball rolling. Before we start. Hi, Shruti. Hi, Somitra. Good evening. Good evening, Somitra. Good to see you. Chiku, are you with me? Please unmute your mic if you can.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Bharat, are you there with us?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes. Perfect. So Chiku, why don't you share some of the names of the people?
I have a doubt. Can I ask a question? Pushpa? Actually, last time I'd asked a question, but I think I redirected it.
Pushpa, you'll have to unmute your microphone, please. I had to mute the audience.
That was actually what I was asking is, when you're directing questions, do I have to, when you're directed at someone? Because last time I asked a question, but I think it was not heard by the person who should have. So it went to somebody called Anvesha, whereas I think it should have directed it to you, Jacob. So you were chat manager. So is it like that I should direct it to somebody?
So if you actually just put it... direct the chat to everyone. Place your chat, your questions in this box, please. And if it's directed to everyone, Pushpa ma'am, then I can copy your questions and save it, and then Divya will take it from there. So
okay,
just type your questions there. Can you just type a question there, and then I can take it from there?
Okay, right.
I'm placing the question marks there. Yeah, thank you. And if you asked a question that was in the public forum, we will also place the blog link from the last Q&A session so that you can see all the questions that were answered by Bharat post the event.
Okay.
Shall I go ahead, Jacob?
Actually, it's five. Should we start? We can take the questions in between.
Yeah.
Is that okay?
Work. Sure.
Okay. Sure.
Can work.
All right, then let's go ahead and start. Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. And welcome to this webinar on volunteer management. This is the second in a two-part series. We had one last week where we spoke about how to build a community of passionate volunteers and how to continue engaging with them. And this time we'll actually be talking about going into details into volunteer management and what are the best practices and tips and tricks around that. I'd like to quickly introduce our guest speaker for the day. We have with us Bharat Bhaskaran, who was the Director of Learning and Development at Make a Difference, an NGO working with children in shelter homes. He was part of the human capital team that designed everything from the role of the volunteer to recruiting, onboarding, training, managing, and engaging with them. Currently, he's a freelance trainer and a consultant with multiple firms, engaging them, helping them design their volunteer modules. He is an engineer by qualification and a musician at heart. Thank you so much, Bharat, for leading this webinar too. We had a great audience last time, and I'm sure this one would be equally great, and the audience is quite excited. I'm sure they're looking forward to a wonderful learning experience. Thank you so much again for being here. Chiku, do you want to start slide sharing? Great, thank you. Can you go to the next slide? The next one, yeah, thanks. So I'd like to quickly introduce Jhatka.org in case people don't know who we are. Our aim is to create a progressive India, one that is equitable, inclusive, and sustainable. And our work is built on working towards getting people more engaged in the democratic process. We use innovative technology and public mobilization in order to build this active movement of progressive Indians who will take action to affect change that probably wouldn't be possible if they acted alone. So our model primarily works on online petitions, but we also do some work offline. And we work on environmental issues like air pollution and climate change, and also issues around gender and sexuality and women's rights. So we are a digital campaigning organization, basically. So this is part of our webinar series that we've been doing during COVID. Since we aren't able to be out on the field and actually work with volunteers, we thought it would be a good time to do some knowledge sharing and talk about how to actually engage volunteers, whether online or offline. So yeah, next slide. Great, so a lot of the pictures that you'll see in this entire webinar are photos from the events that we've done in the past. Mm-hmm. So they might be mass distributions or even flogging parties where we would clean up certain parts of the city, or even at different events, our presence at different events. So yeah. And if you have any questions about Jhatka and the work we do, please feel free to reach out to us. I'll give you our contact details a little later towards the end of the presentation. Bharat, you can take it forward.
Thank you so much, Divya. Also, yeah, I just want to thank Jhatka.org for this wonderful opportunity where I feel really happy to talk about something that I'm really passionate about. And now for the second time, so continuing from where I left off. Yeah, it feels great to be here and it's great to see so many of you return, which means that the first session had some kind of impact. So I'm very happy to see that. Awesome. So let's move on to the next slide. I'm going to do a very quick recap. Also, just double checking, am I audible?
Yes, now it's better. Maybe you'll need to hold your mic.
Yeah. Is this better?
Yes.
All right. Perfect. Yeah, these are some of the house rules. Divya, if you want to quickly run through these.
Yes, I'll do that. So yeah, please, let's make sure we're respectful of each other. Please note that the webinar will be recorded and we will be sharing it we'll be uploading it on YouTube. Please mute your microphones at all times. The event host will mute all microphones as and when required. Let's make sure one person speaks at a time. We will open for questions once in the middle and also towards the end after Bharat has concluded his presentation. But in the meantime, please continue typing your questions in the chat box and Jacob will take note of them. In the interest of time, we may not be able to answer all your questions, but we'll make sure we get back to you with the answers after the webinar. In the interest of a healthy experience, we reserve the right to maintain decorum. And if you have any further questions, please write to us on info@chatka.org with volunteer engagement 2 in the subject line. Thank you.
Yeah. All right. Just double checking one more time for the audience. My volume is okay. Volume and voice. Voice, I can't do much. Volume, I definitely can.
Yeah.
Voice helps.
Very good.
I've been this way for good 20 years now. All right, awesome. Let's move on. Chiku, if you can move on to the next bunch of slides. So I'll do a very quick recap of what we did in the previous session. I was talking about my experience, and if you see, this photo is one of my most favorite photos in my volunteering journey. I started volunteering around 2013 when I was fresh out of college, just started working, and I was looking for something to do apart from working on weekdays for a software company. I was looking for something to do, and that's when I came across this volunteering opportunity with Make a Difference, and that completely transformed and changed my life. So over the next 7 years, what I've been doing is working with volunteers, working as a volunteer. And over the last year, especially, I've been trying to reverse engineer this to make sure that I'm able to give that experience to every volunteer that I went through, to make sure that volunteers do learn a lot and have a great time volunteering for whichever organization that they want to volunteer with, right? Moving on. In the next slide, you will see the things that we spoke about. The next slide, you will see that all volunteer-based systems are either full-time volunteers, part-time volunteers, or one-off volunteers. So as each of you who's here today trying to listen in to this call, if you're working with one-off volunteers or part-time volunteers or full-time volunteers, even if you're working with employees or staff, whatever I'm talking about, full-time volunteers can be applied to them. I think last week we didn't make that distinction. So if, like, all of this is fully applicable to you working in teams when you're leading or managing a team, right? This information doesn't matter if it's volunteering or a full-time employee as well, right? Moving on, we also spoke about the mindsets that we need to communicate with volunteers. So we spoke about how there is an us versus them mentality. We said, let's not do that. Treat your volunteers as a singular unit along with you. We also spoke about coming from a space of care and support. We also spoke about good versus bad volunteers. And if you remember, it was a trick question. There is no bad volunteers or good volunteers. We only have more engaged volunteers or not engaged volunteers, right? After we spoke about mindsets, we quickly spoke about what drives engagement and mobilization. So if you move on to the next slide, Chiku, you can quickly look at these because these are still fully applicable for today's presentation as well. We spoke about when do we as individuals feel engaged? When you're enjoying yourself, when you're cared for and supported, when you're learning and growing, when you're challenged beyond your potential, when you're creating an impact, when you feel like your time is being utilized, when you feel like you belong, you feel like you're a part of that group. and when you feel heard and involved. So when you reverse engineer, this is exactly the experience you want to create for your volunteers. Make sure they're having fun, make sure they're cared and supported for, make sure they're learning, growing, all of that, right? Then the next piece is the touch points for volunteer engagement. In the next slide, you will see a lot of different touch points where you can interact with your volunteers. We'll stay on this slide for a minute, just so that you remember these different platforms where you can interact with your volunteers. So even when you're doing volunteer management, you know you can reach out to them during recruitments, during onboarding, during trainings, on chats, WhatsApp groups, social media, on video calling platforms, and so on. And lastly, post-COVID era, meet them face-to-face and interact with them, right? I know I'm going a little fast, but it's okay because it's just a recap of what we did last week. So don't worry about if you're not able to catch up with the speed at which I'm going. Moving on to the next slide. We spoke about some ideas for engagement and mobilization, and the two main themes we touched upon were capacity building and building connections, right? So capacity building, you can quickly skim through these. For those of you who joined last week, it'll be a quick refresher. For those of you joining just this time, you can also quickly look at these. Like, these are some ideas that you can do. Most of these are self-explanatory. There's one at the end where I said TED Talk Mondays, where on your WhatsApp group, you can share a TED Talk and have discussions with your volunteers. And they also feel engaged and feel like they're growing and learning, right? The next slide is about building connections, not networking. Similarly, you can quickly skim through these slides, and the only non-self-explanatory ones are gratitude circles, where you sit with your volunteers. It's called circles because usually you sit in a circular format and you share gratitude to each other for the impact they've had on the organization or in your life personally. And then there's this whole aspect of Fun Fridays, which, just like TED Talk Mondays, allows you to hang with your volunteers on a specific day, so they know that Friday is scheduled for fun. So it's always good to add it into your volunteering routine that some days are meant for learning and development, some days are meant for fun and getting to know each other better, right? So that was a very quick summary of everything we spoke about on our last call. If you have any questions, we'll take them later because for people who attended it last week, we already answered a lot of their questions, right? So when we talk about volunteer management, let's look at some of the mindsets that we must have when we come into volunteer management. Next slide, please. Again, repeating, there are no good or bad volunteers. There are only highly engaged volunteers or less engaged volunteers, right? When you create volunteer management systems that allow you to track the growth or progress or performance of your volunteers, always come from a space of care and support, resulting in a trustworthy environment. Especially when you're working with volunteers, if the level of trust is low, they are also going to move on, right? So if you're tracking that, say, a volunteer has been absent 4 weeks in a row, your system should tell you that, but how you deal with that information is by coming from a space of care and support when you talk to your volunteers. Next, volunteer management. No, not the next slide. Sorry. Volunteer management is a process. Therefore, there are no gray areas. Look at processes as black and white. Look at ideas as gray, right? I want to make that distinction very clear, especially when you're creating processes, you want to have scores or points or different things associated where something is correct or wrong, or something is good or bad, irrespective of the environment it's in, irrespective of the situation. That's why the process is created like that. But how you respond to that process, how you react to it, is by coming from a space of care and support. Therefore, it balances out that. Otherwise, what happens in a feeling-based volunteering system is you think, okay, this volunteer is doing okay-ish. This volunteer is not doing okay. Suddenly, you've scaled up. You have 1,000 volunteers. This okay-ish, not good system does not work. Therefore, you create black and white processes which allow you to look at any environment and say, okay, this is allowed, this is not allowed. This is okay, this is not okay. This is high, this is low. But how you respond and how you communicate with them is from a space of care and support, right? Again, while this is a process, you also need to make it a part of your volunteer culture. Buy-in is of utmost importance. And when I say that, I mean, right when you recruit them or right when you onboard them, you set expectations that these are the processes you are using to track volunteer progress. If they are aware and they know that it's a part of your culture, you're going to have them support you, right? Otherwise, think of it as a school attendance system. All of us, when we went to school, knew that our attendance was tracked. And sometimes we also knew that what we needed to do to get that 70% attendance so that we can write our exams. So systems are going to have their ways around it. But as long as people are aware, it is also a transparent culture, right? The next point is one of the most important ones, which is think in terms of multiple years. Let's say you're tracking volunteer attendance over a year and you start next year and they start from scratch again. That is not a good system, because you're not able to track how your volunteer's attendance was last year compared to this year. So we use single sheets, we just write names, then we open another sheet and write their names again. That is not a good enough system for you to scale, especially if you're scaling, especially if you're going over multiple years, you want to have the right kind of impact. You need to think of volunteer management through multiple years, right? Then there is no room for bias. Volunteers must at all times feel treated fairly. So the way you set your volunteer management rules, make sure that it treats every volunteer the same way. No two volunteers should be like, hey, he's getting the better end of the deal, I'm not. That's what happens in a feeling-based volunteer management system, right? Then a slightly controversial piece around, it's okay to ask volunteers to leave. Because if treated as an organization that's trying to achieve something, and if someone's not fitting in, it's okay to ask them to leave. But how you have the conversation matters a lot. If they're going to have a bad experience with the exit, then that's not good. If you can tell them why it's not working out and tell them that this is the best we can do and it's best you move on, I think it's a good space where both parties feel treated okay. The last piece again is something for you all to wonder about. Volunteer management ideally should not drive a rewards based system. It should drive an appreciation based system. I know a lot of NGOs which have best volunteer award, best classroom award, best city award. The challenge with that system is it means one group of people are creating more impact than the other. And if you're passionate about your cause, you want everybody to receive impact. So it's something for all of you to think about. And this is definitely debatable. But my policy or my way of thinking about this is that it shouldn't drive a rewards-based system. It should drive an appreciation-based system. Right? Again, like last time, at this point, I quickly want to take two or three questions to see how all of you are feeling. If you have any urgent questions, you can ask them right away. Otherwise, we'll take them at the end of the session.
Doesn't look like there are questions as of now.
Okay. Sounds good. So we'll answer all your longer questions about different situations that you're going through or your organization is facing. We'll definitely answer those. Just any questions where you didn't understand something I've shared so far, we can take one or two. Otherwise, I think good to move on.
Hello, Bharat.
Yeah. Hi.
Yes, this is Sheena. Could you further explain the appreciation-based system?
Yes, I can do that. So in a rewards-based system, like I said, you have say best classroom, best teacher, best city, best volunteers, awards like that or rewards. Whereas in an appreciation-based system, ideally what you want to do is you have appreciation for, say, taking good classes, which means it can be given to literally everyone who takes good classes. Something on the lines of appreciation from each other also. Like if I was taking a class or if I was doing an event and it took 15 people to set up and do this event, at the end of it, all 16 of us sit together and appreciate each other for the effort we put in and talk about how each person played an important role, as opposed to giving the event organizer of the year award to that one person who is managing this event. You understand the difference?
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. That's a really good question.
Yeah. Hi, Oscar.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we have some of the questions from our responses. I would like to pick up that question with you.
So my question is, if it's a doubt about what I said, then we'll take it now. Otherwise, we'll take it at the end.
Okay. Sounds good.
Let's resume in that case. Yeah, if you could share your screen. Thank you. Okay. Next slide, please. Yeah, let's look at some of the parameters or what do you actually track when we talk about volunteer management, right? You track individual information and collective information. Let's open out what these two are in our next slide. So when you track individual information, you track personal information, which is name, email, contact number, birthday, anything that you want to track that will help you get their individual information that is unique to them. Then there's performance data, which is again individual. Attendance, role in the organization, training and onboarding data, whether they've attended your programs, trainings, all of that. I have put an asterisk, if you can see, in attendance and role in the organization. The reason I've done that is these are multiple year data. So if this year I'm a level one volunteer and next year I'm a level two volunteer, ideally your volunteer management system must show that I have progressed in your system. Whereas over a linear 1 year wise data tracking, you may not even realize that that information has skipped. Similarly, attendance sort of flows from 1 year to another. And performance, again, can be anything, right? It can be anything that you want to track that tells you if a volunteer is doing their role well or not, right? So I've given three for easy tracking, but I'm sure you'll find more based on your organization. Moving on to the next slide, we can track behaviors. We can track skill set or knowledge, and we can track fundraising. So behavior, again, is up to you, especially in a transparent system. You don't want to put labels on people as good or bad or like good communicator or like someone who's behaving well, not behaving well. But if as an organization, you just want to track, you can have like a level one or a level two where everyone in level one, you have no issues with as a volunteer. They're not late or they're on time. their interaction with other people is good. There are no escalations against their name. And level two, maybe people that, you know, you want to look at and have conversations and help them develop with in context of their behavior. It's not common. It's not something you need to have. But if you want, I've just put it out here. Then, especially organizations where you have specialists in the organization, you want to track if your if your volunteer is at a beginner stage, intermediate stage, advanced stage. So say your organization that teaches children, and you have people who are already full-time teachers as your volunteers, then you want to give them an advanced stage so that it allows you to track how your different volunteers are doing. And you know you have field experts already in your volunteering base. So it's good to always track something like that. Lastly, most NGOs, most organizations do a lot of fundraising. And if your volunteers are a part of your fundraising team, it's good to track individual fundraising of each of your volunteers. Again, this is just a subset of what all you can track. I'm sure you'll find more things to track when you start setting up this process. Collective information that you ideally track is sourcing, recruitment, attrition, retention, and fundraising. Sourcing is the kind of people that are out there who need to hear your voice and join your organization. So sourcing data is, okay, to run this campaign, I need 800 people. So you track that through your leads, you track how many people are you reaching out to, all of that comes under sourcing. Then recruitment data is how many people have signed on, how many people have joined you, what are their details, all of that. Then attrition data is people who leave either say after one event, people who leave just after signing up, people who leave after attending your training, people who leave after a year. You can track this at so many different levels. And it inputs directly back into your operational efficiency and how you're running your programs. Retention data, on the other hand, also tells you how many people are staying on, reason for staying on, anything that you want to track, you can track through that. And like I said, you track individual fundraising data. You also want to track group fundraising data for your organization itself, right? These are, again, very small list of things you can track. At Make a Difference, we've tracked like so many more things. But these are some bare minimum, a few things that you can start off with, right? Moving on to the next slide. How do you track this? Here are some tools that we've used in the past. There's Microsoft Excel, Google Sheet, Power BI for dashboarding. Zoho Creator is from the company Zoho, where they have a provision for you to create a small app for yourself through this. So if you're if you have a technology team, you can get them to use this app to create smaller apps for your company, for your organization. Then there's Google Data Center, Salesforce, which is an employee management tool, and so on, right? So that already gives you features to track over multiple years. At this point, I quickly want to tell you, if you're starting right now, if you're starting to build your volunteer management process right now, start with Microsoft Excel or Google Sheets. Start here, prototype, build benchmarks, build baselines. Once you're sure that this is how you want to track information, run it for a cycle or a year or an academic year, however your organization works. Run it, make as many iterations as you can, finalize how you want it to look, how you want it to look over multiple years, and then transfer to another platform from where you can keep tracking. That is one of the best suggestions I can give you, because if you directly go into apps and you realize that the features are not working best for you, it can get super confusing and derail all the tracking that you want to do. And it gets so confusing that you'll stop tracking because you're like, I'd rather not use this tool and not track it all and go back to a feeling-based system, right? So this is a good place to start: Google Sheets, Microsoft Excel. Moving on, these are some dashboards that I've used at Make a Difference. For example, you're tracking, here it says Volunteer Leadership Circle. It's just our onboarding program. So for 23 cities, we've tracked, say, user count, continuing volunteers, how many continuing volunteers attended this program, how many new volunteers attended. So like I said, a multiple year system where each city has X number of volunteers. Those volunteers are broken down into volunteers who are continuing over multiple years and new volunteers, right? The data is dummy, please don't look at that. It's just an idea of how you want to dashboard. And if you move on to the next slide, I've clicked on one of those cities. Here it says Ahmedabad. You can see the different departments that are there in the city. So for each of those departments, again, how many continuing volunteers, how many of them attended, how many of them are new volunteers, how many of them attended, and so on. And if you click further, which I have not screenshotted, you will see each of their names and see if they've attended or not. That's the kind of breakdown you have, right? This is another dashboard that we've used at Make a Difference. All I want you to see is it's a very complicated, huge sheet with data that's coming from at least 40, 45 other sheets and other documents. So ideally, you want to create a data sheet which is pulling data from all your other sheets and trackers that allows you to look at data at one glance, right? Doing this will take you some time. That's why I said it is something you'll have to do by sort of prototyping, building a little bit first, getting a hang of what all information you want to track, how do you want to track it. Then anybody with tech experience can dashboard these for you and put them together in one single document where you can view all your data, right? So the purpose of this slide, this image, was just to show you that it can go through that many layers of complexity, right? Now moving on to the next slide. Now you have data, you know what to track. What do you do with this information? Starting with, first, you create baselines for performance, or you create baselines for volunteer attendance, create baselines for anything that you want to track, which means, okay, if someone has done 4 events in a month out of 8 events, they are okay, they are good to go. So like I said, right, that's your black and white. It's not gray area. Around 4 does not make sense. 4 or 3 or whatever, however you want to track, you have those. And you have those baselines. Once you create those baselines, everybody above those baselines, you get on calls with them and you do appreciation calls, letting them know that they're doing right. They're doing everything that the org wants them to do. And they're going above and beyond, right? Second kind of calls that you can do is check-in calls. So just check in or check up on your volunteers who are around the baseline mark, just making sure that they're doing okay, they're having a good experience, right? This is also volunteer engagement, if you realize. It carries on from our previous session. Then there's developmental calls. So say if you've decided that the benchmark is 4 out of 8 and they've attended 3 or they've attended 4, you want to get on a developmental call and say, hey, I feel like you can do better, or this is what is needed. And you're sort of slacking, can we sort of make sure that you're picking up and doing your, like making sure you're contributing, right? Again, it's how you have the conversation that matters. And lastly, if you have someone who's say showing up for 0 out of your 8 events or anything way below your threshold, you do exit calls with them. That being said, I also want to say that this is the flow of conversations. You cannot do an exit call without doing a developmental call. You can't suddenly call a volunteer and say, hey, we need to let you go without doing a developmental call. So then you set the culture that you are taking care of your team members. When they fall, you give them a call, tell them that you're there to support them. And if they're still not able to continue, if they're still not able to do what is expected of them, then you know that, hey, we've done everything from our side. I think it's time to let you go. Right? That speaks so much better than you just calling somebody and saying, hey, I think it's time to let you go. Right? Then use this information to promote your volunteers to give them more responsibilities. Right? When you create baselines, when you create these, you realize that some volunteers are doing way more than another volunteer. I'm not saying way better, I'm saying way more. Right? I think what you can do is make sure that you identify those who have been putting in more hours, more effort, trying to do everything that they can do, whatever it takes. Promote those volunteers, give them leadership roles. Like we spoke about in volunteer management, make sure that they are supporting other volunteers because they've got something right. They're doing it right. Right? So that's something that you can do with this information. Next slide, please. These are some of the last recommendations and ideas that I have that you can try out. Create a transparent credit system for attendance tracking. A credit system is where you allot a score to people for coming for an event or showing up to a classroom, whatever it is that your organization is doing. Create a credit system where they get plus one or plus two for showing up, minus one, minus two if they're absent. So you sort of gamify it so that even your volunteers know, okay, this is my score, this is what I need to do. Next slide, please. Yeah. This is what I need to do to stay on top. And it's a good gamification that you can do when you're managing your team, right? Create platforms that allow volunteers to escalate issues. A volunteer management system, apart from playing a role of you gauging your volunteers' performance, also is a platform for volunteers to escalate any challenges they're facing on ground. So if they're facing harassment, if they are not happy with their leaders or with their managers, if they are not having a good experience, anything, they should ideally be able to escalate that to you. And volunteer management systems are a platform where they can do that, right? That's why you're doing check-in conversations with them. Always make sure you add questions to gauge their experience. Next. Create a culture of data-driven decision-making. Share that data with your volunteers as well. So they are also fully aware of what data is visible to you. Make that visible to them so that they can also take decisions at your level. We spoke about this in the previous previous conversation as well, right? If your volunteers have the level of information that you have, then they can also level up and become your level, right? They can become full-time employees, directors, whatever roles that you're playing, only if you give volunteers all the information you have, right? At the end of the day, volunteer management processes help you identify outliers. So basically people who are doing really well and people who are not doing well at all. So use it mainly for that. Don't use it to create a system where everybody has to update 20 trackers a day to track process and all of that. The easiest way is to look at it to identify outliers so that you can promote people who are doing more and sort of ask people to leave if at all, if they're not able to keep up, right? The next point is track performance and impact separately as they may not go hand in hand, right? What happens is as organizations, we track or give credit to volunteer performance as much as our impact. So let's say you're teaching in a classroom and you have volunteer attendance of say 200%, or you have more people show up, or volunteers attendance has spiked in the last month. But if it is at the cost of say dip in quality of the classroom teaching that you're trying to do, ideally, you should be tracking them separately. I like how someone's drawing on the screen. Distracting me also. So use this information only to track volunteer performance or volunteer management. Do not connect that to impact. They may be correlated, but they are not definitely directly correlated. So sometimes what happens is we think that volunteers being happy, volunteers having a great experience means impact on ground is great. Unless your volunteers are your beneficiaries, it may not be the case. Right? And lastly, another thing you can track is something that we do at Make a Difference, which is you can track the happiness of your volunteers through a happiness survey, ask them all the right questions, create that as a platform for escalation, and you can track that as well if you want to try something out that is advanced. Right? And before we go to question and answers, I want to leave you with one last thought, which is in the previous slide. Yes. Build systems and processes that are intuitive and easy to manage. It is not useful if it takes longer to update trackers than to do the activity itself. If you're tracking, say, phone calls that people are doing or number of phone calls, it takes me 2 minutes to do a phone call and it takes me 25 minutes to update the tracker saying I've done the phone call, then your tracker is not really doing its purpose. Right? So make it as easy and as intuitive as possible. Volunteer management systems can consume us if we don't make it easy for people to use. Right? With that, I know I've shared a lot of information heavy session today. I would also like to take your opinions, your questions. Before that, I think just quickly leaving some contact information for all of you. I'm currently working as a freelance facilitator and consultant. I work with organizations building their volunteer management, volunteer recruitment, volunteer sourcing, mobilization, engagement, fundraising, all of that. And if you want to collaborate or even if you want to just talk about this, this is one of my favorite topics and I'm very passionate, you can reach out to me, like I said in the last call, in an email ID that I created as a child and thought was very cool. It's bharatdigb@gmail.com. Then there is my Instagram and Twitter and LinkedIn IDs. Instagram and Twitter, you can find me on what I thought was very cool in 2010s. Sorry, previous slide, please. Hello. Yeah. Instagram and Twitter, you can find me on Don Bratman, and LinkedIn, you can find me at Bharat Paskaran. You can also reach out to the folks at jhatka.org, where their website is jhatka.org, their info. You can also reach out for this session if you have any extra questions that you want to ask later. You can reach out to info@jhatka.org with the subject line for today's, that is today's topic. There, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook is at jhatka.org with a D-O-T, not a dot.
Thanks. Can you go to the Q&A slide, Chiku? So that, yeah. All right. So I'm going to read out some of the questions, Bharat. So the first one is, how do we retain volunteers effectively? And is there a framework for something like that?
I think the framework is doing all of, not necessarily all, but a collection of everything we spoke over the last two sessions, which is doing a lot of volunteer engagement, making sure they have a good experience. And only then you know that they are going to continue in the organization into the next year. So that is possible only if they're engaged well, mobilized well. Mm-hmm.
Should I ask the next question?
Yes, please.
Okay. The next one is, how often should you do volunteer orientation or like an onboarding?
how often depends on how the cycle of your organization is. So basically, if let's say you have 3 month cycles, or you have 1 year cycle, or you have a semester 6 month cycle, then ideally you do onboarding and recruitment programs for each cycle. So sometimes I understand it's difficult to get all your volunteers together in one place. So at Make a Difference, we do around three rounds, which is, if say it's 1 year, we do induction or onboarding program in the month of April, May, June for the entire year, which starts in April and ends in, May, June, July, and it ends in April. So in those 3 months, we do a lot of onboarding programs, and then they run for the entire year. So that, yeah.
Mm-hmm. The next question is, how do we motivate volunteers to create the larger impact? And how do we link that with their personal aspirations?
Right. I think it's good if you can, at the sourcing level itself, identify their personal aspirations and connect that to your cause and bring them in. If there is a match, they are going to go all out to make sure that you're able to achieve that. I think also in the due process of them volunteering with you, keep showing them the bigger picture. If volunteers are not aware of the bigger picture, say you're working across the world and you're working in classrooms, if a volunteer is only thinking about their classroom, then they're not likely to think of the larger impact. While it's really important that they think of their classroom, it may not be best in context of the impact that they're trying to create.
Right. There was another question on exit calls and if it tarnishes an organization's image.
I don't think so. I think it's important that as an organization, you also realize that when there is no synergy, or when there's no mix of people's expectations or what they want, where the organization is heading, I think it's okay. But it completely depends on how you have that conversation.
Mm-hmm.
Depends on how well you close that loop, because otherwise they will go out feeling really disappointed, feeling upset.
Right. So we had a bunch of questions from Ishita. I'm just going to read them out. Maybe you can club them together. One was, what are some of the best avenues to source volunteers based on organizational needs, and how do we incentivize that? Because even though we try to work towards the appreciation model, sometimes it's ineffective, especially when we have young students who opt for volunteering more because their schools or colleges require them, or they need it for, you know, their further college applications. And right. So in that case, how do you create accountability?
I think that's exactly when a lot of organizations think about this. I think it's okay to look at it from a different lens, which is people are volunteering their time and you incentivize them giving their time. So if you want to have rewards, you can have rewards for this volunteer has committed 100 hours.
Mm-hmm.
And after they finish that 100 hours, you give them a, like, it's more like a level up reward rather than a reward that's pitted against somebody, right? So every 100 hours they volunteer with you, you can give them a certificate of appreciation or any kind of incentive that you want to give, right? As opposed to saying this volunteer is the best volunteer, this volunteer is better than another. Mm-hmm. It may drive as a motivational force, but knowing our mindsets, knowing how we've come up in a competitive world, ideally it should not be at the cost of, now I know I'm working towards becoming the best volunteer, so I may have resources which I could have given another person or another team, but I deny giving them that because I know I'm going to win this. And that competitive system in an NGO or in a volunteering space can get super tricky, and I steer very clear from it, because I know that if people get competitive, they it sort of becomes at the cost of winning over other people. And in an NGO, I don't think, or in a non-profit or a volunteering organization, that need not be the case.
Right. Okay. We have lots more questions. Before that, while I go to the next question, Jacob is going to be pasting a link to a very quick feedback survey on this webinar. It'll be really great if folks can fill that out while we're doing the Q&A session. It'll take you just a couple of minutes to do it. It'll be really useful for us for our future webinars as well. So thank you. Jacob is just going to paste that on the chat. Okay, next question. What are some of the guidelines we need to put down when involving volunteers virtually?
Right. I think it works if you can set expectations with them that, you know, when you're doing calls, you want them to stay on video, you know, ideally off mute, where the interactions are as real as it would be on ground. So those are some kind of some sort of expectations where you want them to be truly present, and where it's a space where they can also like treat it professionally. I think there is some context where you want them to be professional about this virtual volunteering as well. I think a few organizations are exploring that aspect where people can volunteer virtually completely. Like, you could be anywhere in the world. Can you come teach my classroom of children? So NGOs or organizations worry about the infrastructure, worry about the hardware that can be given to children. And then volunteers come from anywhere across the world to teach. So you want to set expectations that allow this to be as real as possible. It's not like we can tend to overcomplicate it. I think the that would be the bare minimum expectation that we can have.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Another question is it possible to apply these practices to people management in general? Would you like to answer that, Bharat?
Yes, I definitely think so. I think it's changed how I look at people management, because when you look at volunteering, you look at people who you're not paying, right? People who are probably doing it free of cost, giving you their time. And if you can motivate, manage, mobilize these people, people who are just giving you their time, which means they're giving you their most valuable resource and not in return for money, the lessons that you learn here easily allow you to translate that to team management, where, say, people are already incentivized by money. If they come, if they give you their time, you're going to give them money instead.
Right.
So these work hundredfold in such environments.
Okay. So there's a question from Atul. How would you suggest we collect qualitative data aimed at the growth of your volunteers?
Yeah, I think quality depends on how well you define your parameters and how directly you link it to impact, right? Volunteer attendance may or may not be directly related to, say, the education a child is receiving in a classroom, but it does have some correlation, right? So based on your organization, you'll have to realize what parameters allow you to test for quality. Like I said, an example that I gave was happiness index, where you're testing how happy and satisfied your volunteers are with your organization. That is a direct qualitative metric for your organization's operations, not for its impact on what you're trying to achieve, but for your operations, for your people management, for your skills, or anything that you're doing to take care of your people. I feel like that is something that you can create, right? But as for on-ground impact, you'll have to see the correlation. You'll have to see what factors directly influence quality and by what factor, right? The different factors here. So do that and calculate and then come up with some qualitative information.
Okay. Right. So we have a question from Pushpa. When you have a volunteer who shows an inclination to perhaps adopt unorthodox methods that are not in line with the culture of the organization, to what level can he or she be allowed to continue in the organization?
I think that's an excellent question, because this happens most often than not. People come in with their good intent to volunteer, and then they use unorthodox methods. They use different things that perhaps they want to try out in the context of the organization. As someone who's managing this team or this person, you need to understand their intent, which is, if they are coming from a space of, I want to do something that is best for the child, in this case, because I've used the classroom example, or best for the cause, you can start your conversation like that. I understand that you have the best interest at heart here, but your methods are unorthodox. And I think dialogue is the way forward. And ideally, you find a middle ground, or you find a space where both parties feel satisfied. Or if the other person is like, no, I want to do it this way, then you as an organization may have to put your foot down and say, then this may not be the best place for you.
Mm-hmm.
I think dialogue is the way forward, understanding where they're coming from, but appreciating their intent already puts you on the right track, and right. Looking at it from that point of view.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a very good question.
So Supriya says she works with children with street children. She wants to know how she can get teenage children from ages 16 to 20 to volunteer.
Right. If it's something you're starting off just now, without if it's a new organization or a new initiative that you're taking up, start however you want. There is no rules for how to go about this. Do it organically. Find people who are passionate. Start with your neighborhood. Start with your community. Start with people you know. Start with your Instagram, your Facebook, your Twitter network. Once you get about 20, 30 people to do this together, slowly build from their networks, their Instagram, their community, their building, their house. They bring in more people. Mm-hmm. And once you get like a stable base of people, and you know exactly what you want to do with the children in your community, with the help of these teenage volunteers, you build a program around it, or you build an initiative around it. And slowly, like, your first batch of people are going to be the most passionate, because they are what you call founders of your organization along with you. They are going to be passionate. Try and do anything and everything that you want. And over the course of 1 year or 2 years, start putting processes in place if you want to scale this up, if you want it to become an organization.
Right. Okay. How do we keep, so Amit asks us, how do you keep volunteers aligned with the organization's purpose?
By repeating it. I think I'm a strong believer of repeating your vision, your mission, your strategies, whatever it is. Start at the sourcing level, when you're already trying to reach out to them on social media, wherever it is. As they join your organization, repeat it again. Get them to repeat it. Get them to internalize it. Do it through training programs. Do it on your onboarding. Do it through the year. Every conversation connected back to your organization's vision. Like how today we are going for one cleanup drive event, how that connects back to the larger picture of your organization. Mm-hmm. If you can keep connecting it back, if you can keep repeating it, you know that your volunteers have also internalized it. So find more platforms and touch points where you can keep talking about it.
Mm-hmm.
It also allows your vision, mission to evolve with the buy-in of your volunteers.
Okay. So Ayushi asks, when should we be doing check-in calls?
At least depends. So if your organization time frame is 1 year is a term, or 6 months is a term. Ideally, every 15 days to 30 days would be good. But let's say your volunteers are working only for a month, then you may want to check in every 2-3 days as well, based on that. But ideally, they should be hearing from someone in the organization every once in a while who's checking up on them, making sure that they are having a good experience. You can decide the frequency.
Mm-hmm. Oh, this is a good question. So we have this question. How do you keep, if you need to keep volunteers engaged, basically children who are, you're directly engaging with them unsupervised online, what are the measures that need to be taken to ensure child safety and privacy?
Right. I've never really worked with children online, so I can take a few guesses. I think one of the biggest lessons I've learned by teaching children in classrooms itself is treat them as adults. You can set expectations with them, telling them what you want from them. How would this be useful for them? Take their opinion. That really helps. Telling them, okay, this is a two-way conversation. This is what we want to do. And this is how this would help you out. So let's talk about what would be best guidelines that we can follow as a group. Then as an adult, you're also supervising to make sure that they are having a good experience and there's safety for them. But I think the best way to go about it is treating them as adults and asking them for what they want. We often tend to disregard what children want, especially when we're working with them.
Right. All right, thanks. So it's past six. We are going to continue for another 15 minutes. So if people are interested, you can stay back.
Yes. Big learnings from last week.
Yeah. How do we identify genuine volunteers, as most of them do it for certification? I think it's sort of like the previous, like an earlier question we had. And while if most of them are disengaged and sort of short timers and have a short attention span, how do you keep them engaged? And how do you identify genuine volunteers?
Right. I think it's a very good question. A lot of colleges, universities, different places give students extra credits if they volunteer their time. So they join whatever organization they can find for certificates, right? Your biggest challenge is getting volunteers. So if you can set up volunteer engagement management systems, it doesn't matter if they come for certificate for their own personal satisfaction, if they come for making sure that your organization has, the organization's impact for the cause, any of that. Right? You want volunteers, and it doesn't matter how they join. It's what you do with them once they join. Right? So leave that intent out of the question, out of the equation, and just treat them as any volunteer who's joined voluntarily and focus on giving them a good experience, focus on making sure that they feel that it's the best use of their time. The whole certificate piece comes into the picture when they're not having a good time, but they can't leave because they need the certificate. That's when they get disengaged. That's when they have, a low attention span. That's when they stop showing up and do bare minimum to get their certificate. So I think you can manage that by actually giving them a great experience. Mm-hmm.
So this is a question from Pushpa, who had this, she had this question last Wednesday and we couldn't answer that. So I'm just going to read that aloud here.
Right.
She asks, if you want to convert some active volunteers into full-time volunteers, but also pay them a small remuneration, will this demotivate the other volunteers?
Not necessarily. I think it's how you have the conversation around it. And also maybe open it up for everybody. I think that helps. So you don't either make your criteria for promotion public, where everybody knows how are you promoting them, or you have like auditions or whatever, have interview process for who you want to make full time and open it to everybody. So everybody knows that such a system is there, it's available and people can sign up, right? Transparency is everything in volunteer-based systems.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So does that answer your question?
Yeah, she's nodding.
Ah, awesome.
All right, I think that's about it with the questions.
I think if people have any more, they can also ask out loud.
Yeah, anyone wants to go, you can unmute yourself and ask a question. Okay, I don't think we have any questions. So yeah, this was really great. Thank you so much, Bharat, for taking us through this. And it was a great sequel to the last one. And before we go, I just wanted to quickly say one last thing about chatka.org. We are a small group based out of Bangalore, and we don't have big marketing or fundraising teams, and our long-term vision is to be independent and funded by our members who believe in our work. And so we do accept donations from individuals across the country. So we will leave a link to the donation, to our donation page. But if you want, if you'd like to know more information and how, you know, where your money would be used, etc., please do write to us on info@chatka.org. I'll be happy to also talk to anyone who's who just wants to know more. But yeah, that's about it. So thank you so much. Thank you everyone for joining us. This was a lovely session. Thank you, Bharat, for taking us through this session again. It was really, really insightful, and I hope everyone had a great learning experience. Thank you.
Thank you, Bharat. Excellent session.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Bharat. It was very insightful.
Where was the feedback link? I'm not so technically up. So you said something about some feedback by somebody. Where
yes.
Where did I go to give feedback?
He's just put it on the chat.
Chat itself. Okay. No, something yes. else you said he had filled up. Form or something? No.
It's on the chat.
Yeah, okay. The other piece was last week's questions, which I had answered. That is also here.
Yeah, Jacob has posted
yeah.
a link to our blog. All the questions have been answered there.
Is the link?
Jacob, do you want to paste that again? There it is. All right. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for joining. We hope to see you on some of our future webinars.
We have close to 30 people.
Yeah.